Hi everyone, welcome to my channel. My name's Dahlia, and today I am going to be talking about the book Citizen, an American Lyric by Claudia Rankine. I just don't even know where to begin with this book. It's absolutely stunning, absolutely amazing, and I just want to say it right now, I recommend it to like the entire world, especially if you live in America. I just think this book is so relevant. It's just a very important piece of literature, and I'm really excited to discuss it. So basically, Citizen is kind of a blend of genres. It has poetry, it has prose, some of which are like kind of has an essay quality to it. It has visual art and pictures, and it is just a lovely compilation of work, and it just flows so beautifully. Rankine just has this beautiful way of writing that just kind of leaves you breathless. It makes you jolted, and it's just absolutely amazing. So what is Citizen about? It's basically a book that talks about race and how, like, it talks about like everyday acts of racism, which there's like a term for that, which is a microaggression. And I actually looked up the word microaggression online so I can give you like a dictionary definition instead of trying to explain it in my own words, because I feel like, I don't know, it would be harder. But I got this from Merriam-Webster, and it's a comment or action that is subtly and often unintentionally hostile or demeaning to a member or of a minority or marginalized group. Microaggression is kind of like basically a type of racism, but it's like, again, more subtle. It may be an action, it may be a comment, or words, whatever, that is towards a member of like a marginalized or minority group. And though you may not have the intention of hurting them with what you say, and it still has like an effect on them, on the person. And you know, it could be something very like little, and you don't even realize that you're saying something hurtful. But like the way I learned it here at my school is basically like, think of it like a little tiny pebble. And these people are getting these little tiny pebbles like on a daily basis, like from everywhere. And soon enough, like these pebbles really start to weigh down on them, like when they have just like so many from like just a lifetime of pebbles. And that's basically how heavy of an impact these microaggressions have. And this book, while it does not use the term microaggression, that is basically what is happening here. And, you know, it's shedding light on all these pebbles, and you are thrown into the experience. You witness it firsthand, whether you're a person of color or from a minority group, like, or you're not, like, either way, like, you become a part of the situation and the experience when you're reading this book. And, like, if this is your first time, like, you know, learning about this kind of stuff, and you're reading this book, it's very jolting, it's very uncomfortable, and if you are familiar with this stuff, if you are, you know, a person of color, specifically an African American, because that is what this book primarily focuses on, it is still like very uncomfortable to read, because this is like something you're familiar with, and it's very like, you know, it just hurts a lot, you know. And while I am not African American, I am a person of color. I'm Mexican American, and like, I don't know, this book still made me uncomfortable. It still was a very eye-opening, and just the way it was written, which is something that I'm going to get into right now, it just literally brings you in. It, like, no longer can you just be, like, a bystander. No longer can you, like, turn your eye away from what's happening, you know, no more blind eye. Like, you are, like, up front and center of, like, all these racial, you know, aggressions, this racism. And you know, you just can't ignore it anymore. And the thing about this piece is that it's very, very relevant. It's also like very recent. I don't remember, I don't know when it was published, but it's like, you know, it talks about like Trayvon Martin and Serena Williams and like, you know, a bunch of like, you know, things in between, and it's just, I don't know, it's just so relevant. And yeah, I don't know, I have a hard time believing this, but like, you know, I see online some people really do believe that we live in a post, you know, racial society where, like, you know, racism is no longer, you know, something to worry about because, like, you know, we've moved past that. Well, that's not true. As you can see by, like, our president, as you can see by, like, the current politics of the world, like, you know, even when Obama was in office, there's, you know, there's always been things going on. And, you know, America still has, like, a lot of, you know, moving forward to do because we've got a long way to go. And I think this book is really eye-opening and very important in that discussion of, like, you know, race and equality and all of that. And, you know, it's just so beautifully written. And I don't know, just as you can tell, I love this book. So I did read this book for one of my classes and I loved it. It was actually for a creative writing class, but since I do go to a historically women's liberal arts college, it's very social. My school is very social justice oriented, and so even in a creative writing class, we get books like this that we read and discuss. And even though we're discussing the craft of the book, we're also discussing like the content, which is just as important. And so yeah, I just love this so much. And yeah, so I just want to get into like, yeah, just into more like depth of this book. So there are like a lot of elements that have gone into the craft of this book that just, I don't know, just make it so complicated and so, I struggle how to like describe it. Like, let's, first off, I want to discuss like the design of it. It's all white, as you can see, with really dark, like, you know, black font, you know, really dark image. And as you can see, the image is a hoodie and with, you know, the hands are like bound behind the back. And I feel like this is an icon that like many Americans are familiar with. Whether you fear this icon because, as you know, or as you may know, a hoodie is like, has become like a really big symbol of fear in like white people. That's like where a lot of their, you know, violence has come from, and how they are targeting like these African Americans and these marginalized people because they see them as criminals or as dangerous. And, you know, we see the binding of the arms as like representative of like, you know, police brutality and all of that, like even stop and frisk and all of that. And this just image right here just says so much. And yeah, I don't know, it's just great. And I want to talk more about like, you know, the white contrast with the dark, and you know, because I think that's very important. There is like a line in here where Rankine quotes Zora Neale Hurston, "I feel most colored when thrown against a sharp white background," or something like that. And like, there is an entire page where on one side it says, "I do not always feel colored," which is true. Like, as a person of color, like, you know, you feel like a person, like, you know, you're not always thinking about like, you know, oh my God, I'm a person of color and blah, blah. Like, no, like I'm living my life. And so I feel like this is just like, you can just like insert yourself into these words. And this is like not, the author of this book did not do this, but this is like another artist, and she like, she cites him on the back. She gives him credit. But basically on this side, it says, "I feel most colored when I am thrown against a sharp white background." And it just repeats these words over and over again, one side and then the other side. And it is like very true. It gives you examples of like how someone can feel most colored when they're thrown against a sharp white background. Like I said, there is like a little essay on Serena Williams and how during like the 2004 Olympics or finals or something, the ref was giving her really bad calls because, you know, she's having trouble seeing past Serena's black body, and she, you know, basically was influencing her calls. And though she may not have consciously been, you know, thinking about that, it was something that, you know, was still causing this problem. And though Serena didn't confront it back then, she did feel cheated out of the game because she ended up losing because of the way the ref was making the calls. And 5 years later, when Serena is in another match with a completely different ref, she still feels that weight of, you know, the racism that she experienced from the other ref. And so as a result, she ends up really lashing out on this new ref. And, you know, people are like, oh my gosh, she's like just this angry black woman and blah, 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 you know. But like, she is a black woman who is playing a sport that is like, you know, has a historically like white background. Like, she is this like great figure, like practically the best female player of all time. And she still, you know, well, she couldn't like get the respect of many people because of like her black body. It was getting in the way of like them seeing past that and seeing her for just like a tennis player. And, you know, every time she, you know, defended herself, she lashed out. She, you know, had this weight, you know, on her shoulders where it made her like pissed off and angry. She was labeled as like a bad person, as like very aggressive. And yeah, it's just, you know, it talks about like things like that where like, you know, you have to see past what's going on and like look into the context of the situation. So I loved how like it's all like that kind of thing is like all woven in throughout the book amongst like other things. And another thing I want to talk about is how much of this book is written in the second perspective you. Like, it'll literally say, for example, I want to read this one part about the stop and frisk. I knew whatever was in front of me was happening, and then the police vehicle came to a screeching halt in front of me like they were settling upon a blockade. Everywhere were flashes, a siren sounded, and a stretched out roar. Get on the ground now. Then I just knew. And then there's a shift, and it says, and you are not the guy, and still you fit the description, because there is only one guy who is always the guy fitting the description. And just like a lot of this book is written in like the second person, not even like bringing in the first person. But like, you know, whether you insert yourself into that you or you're just reading it as someone speaking to you, either way, like you become a part of the situation, whether you're, you know, consider yourself the problem or whether you consider yourself like a witness. Either way, you're like experiencing these things. And it just makes these situations very present and very noticeable. Like, it's also like very nameless. So you can apply these experiences to like, you know, a lot of people, or a lot of people can apply themselves into this book, into this work, because, you know, if this is something familiar to you, then of course, like, you're gonna see yourself in this story. And you know, it just like brings a whole nother layer of like reality to it, because, you know, even though it's poetry, even though, you know, it's very lyrical, it still has like a very real groundness to it. Like, I don't know how to explain this, but yeah. And I just feel like it's just so much more effective in like making the reader think, because it uses the word you. It doesn't, you know, describe what this person is feeling, even though they're going through something like extremely like difficult and unnecessary and frustrating and hurtful. And it doesn't describe the emotions. Like, it makes you think about, you know, what you should be feeling, whether it's anger, whether it's frustration, whether it's like hurt or betrayal or whatever. Like, it's forcing you to encompass all those emotions, whether you've experienced these things in real life or not. And I feel like that's just, you know, whether you're a white person or a person of color, African American, or like me, like Mexican, like, you know, you can't ignore these things when, you know, it's upfront and personal. And this book just makes it upfront and personal, and it brings you into the experiences. And that is just like, it just makes it so much more uncomfortable. But because it's uncomfortable, it makes you think more. And yeah, I don't know. It's just, yeah, people say this book is revolutionary. And my teacher, like, showed us an essay. He read us an essay, and the essay was asked, like, revolutionary for who? And then, you know, it's just, like, very interesting when you ask yourself that question. Like, you know, is it revolutionary for, like, you know, community, like, marginalized communities? Is it revolutionary for white people who, you know, are learning about this for the first time? And, you know, it's just, you got to think about this stuff. Like, you know, it's, yeah. Let me see what else I have on tab, like, want to discuss. Okay, so I wanted to read a passage that was like an example of microaggression that is just like super subtle, that you wouldn't expect to be hurtful if you said something like this, but it's again, it's a pebble that weighs down the person in the end of the day. So it says, you wait at the bar of the restaurant for a friend and demand, wanting to make conversation, nursing something. He takes out his phone to show you a picture of his wife. You say, bridge that she is beautiful. She is, he says, beautiful and black, like you. Well, at first glance, he thinks he's giving this person a compliment. Oh yeah, my wife, she's black too, and beautiful, just like you. And, you know, these are things that people say, you know, they're trying to be nice. They're not intentionally trying to hurt people. But again, this is what a microaggression is. This is what it does. Like, you know, it, you know, points out the color in you, the, you know, marginalized identity in you, whether intentional or not. It, like, labels it. It, like, brings that color again against the stark white background. And, you know, he thought he was giving her a compliment. Like, yeah, obviously black people are beautiful. Like, everyone is beautiful. But, like, you know, why do you have to point that out? Why can't, you know, it's just weird. He's, like, I don't know, calling it out. And, yeah, it's, I don't know, it's very, like, unnecessary. And it's, like, kind of awkward. Like, if I was in that situation, I'd be like, oh, okay, thanks, I guess. You know, I'd be like, why? Yeah, it's just so subtle. And, you know, even people, like, who are on the receiving end of that may not see that. But again, like, many people do. Like, this is a compilation of, like, experiences. Like, you know, I don't know if one single person can experience, like, every single thing in this book. But it speaks out for, like, many different people who have experienced these things, who have voiced these things. Like, Rankine, I know, like, my teacher discussed, like, she brought in, like, a whole bunch of voices while she was writing so that she can, like, encompass it in her book and, you know, branch out and, like, touch all these people. Because even though everyone is experiencing different things, like, in the end of the day, like, this is what brings them together. And that's why another thing about the you is that it connects all these experiences and it makes it, you know, an entire, I don't know, like, problem that we need to confront, you know? And yeah, and so there is one more page that I want to actually show you. I have to find it first. Okay. So this page is very interesting. As you can see, there's like a list here, and you can see like it fading out here. And this is like a very quoted part of the book. It says, in memory of Jordan Russell Davis, in memory of Eric Garner, in memory of John Crawford, in memory of Michael Brown, in memory of Laquan McDonald, in memory of Akeem Gurley. And it keeps going and keeps going until the names just start fading off the page. And, you know, what this is saying is basically like there's all these victims who, you know, you hear it on the news, like, all the time, and, you know, there's all these, like, black people dying, you know, and the way it fades out, it's still happening. This is something that's very present, very relevant, still occurring, and what accompanies this page is this that follows, which I think went nice hand in hand with that. Because white men can't police their imagination, black people are dying. And how I interpreted that was like, white men can't police their imagination. I felt like that was like a play on like police brutality, on stop and frisk or whatever it may be, or even like, you know, white people in general who have, you know, violent weapons like guns. Like, you know, if you've heard of Trayvon Martin, he was, you know, shot. And it's just so sad. And these, you know, it's kind of referencing the fact that white men like get this irrational fear. And you know, they see someone and label them as dangerous, and so they attack in order to protect themselves. And that's like, you know, white men can't police their imagination. Like, they can't, you know, see past the color, they can't see past the person's blackness, because for them that represents like danger. And so that's why, like, you know, black people are dying. And so I just thought this page, you know, again, so important. And I think this all goes like hand in hand, and you know, all of this goes hand in hand. And it's, yeah, if I haven't convinced you to read this book by now, then I don't know, like, just read it. I think I might end my discussion here. Like, it's already a really long video, but you just need to read this book. Read it. Yeah, if you want, you should go on Goodreads too and see what other people are saying about this book. But like, just don't even think about it. Just like, pick it up. Because when I went into this book, honestly, I had no idea what it was, what it was about. Like, there's a little blurb here, but I couldn't really like pick up anything from it. And until actually after I finished reading, then I went back and read this, and I was like, oh, I get it now. But yeah, so thank you for watching my very long discussion of Citizen, an American Lyric. I hope you enjoyed that, and I hope that you all end up picking up this book, because I can't recommend it enough. And so, yes, I hope you all have a good day, and if you have read this book, please let me know. I would love to talk about it with you. Okay, bye.